people that want to know the truth and the honesty of it, if they want to be convinced or brainwashed into what they believe, then fine, then go ahead and kill me. But vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, because you will have executed somebody that didn't commit the crime. When they paint the image that I was this monster who picked up like these altar boys along the street and swatted them like flies, I said, this is ludicrous. I've taken three and a half hours of truth serum. And under sodium amethyl, the maximum amount that I could have, it shows that I have no knowledge of the crime whatsoever. Never have had. Loving and caring. I've always looked after my children, even now.
What kind of values do you remember imparting to them?
The kind of values?
Were you strict with them, too?
No, not as strict. A lot of things that my dad did, I refused to do. Because I don't believe in hitting children. I don't believe in spoiling a child either. My values are such that if you give enough love to the children...
You're accused of murdering 33 kids and you say you didn't believe in hitting. I mean...
Well, anybody that knows... You see, first of all, you're basing this garbage on what you've heard of me.
What happened to... What happened in the Bukovic case? Where was he picked up and how did he get to the house and what happened with him?
I don't want to go into the other the five that I know about. Just take it that I didn't. Bukovic is not one that I killed, so I don't know nothing about him. The little bit that I know about him is that he was an employee of mine. See, when you look about this recall business, and
I'm not a prosecutor, John, but you just
I know
said
you're not.
Bukovic
wait a minute.
Is not one that you killed, which suggests that maybe in fact there were others that you did kill.
I'm sorry if I led you to believe. No, strike it then. That is wrong. If you want to charge me with anything, charge me with complicity in two of the murders.
Just two?
That's all I know about. Robert Peace was killed by another individual in my home.
How did he get to your home?
He was transported to the house by another.
How did the other, whoever he was, kill Robert Peace?
I believe he was strangled.
You were there, right?
Not during the crime, but I was there afterwards and I watched the removal of the body.
And what happened to the body afterwards? Was one that was, that, was that body was river, put into the river?
It was taken to the river and dumped in the river.
Did you help do that?
Yes, I'm in complicity with that. I've always contended. Don't look at me as an innocent babe of the woods. In regards to going out into the garage, yes, I know I went to the house and yes, I know I walked in the garage and they asked me where the last section of concrete was poured. Okay. I said, there's the last section where the last section of concrete was poured. Okay, they are the ones that took the orange can of paint and said, here, put a mark there. So I put an X there.
So the paint was not to identify the place of burial?
No. No, it never was. They asked, shoelaces, huh? You're in trouble now.
Yeah, right.
Aren't you afraid sitting that close to me? What the hell? Oh, this is too long. You don't need it this long. Okay. I had a rosary, which I carried in my pocket. I've always carried a rosary. It was my communion rosary. They said, well, what kind of a knot do you use? I said, what do you mean knot? When I tie things up? I says, depending on what I'm using it for, I said, the only thing I ever learned was from Boy Scouts is a tourniquet knot. He said, well, show us what that is. So I took, at that time, and again, it's together, but in order to demonstrate it here, I took the rosary and I said, well, here, you put it around. This is hard trying to do this. Why don't you put your hand out? Okay, here. What I told him, I said, here, all you do is you wrap it around, you put one knot in it. And I said, then you put a second knot in it. Okay? Mm-hmm. I said, then you take a stick and stick it in here, and you just turn this. And I said, it causes a tourniquet. I said, that's the only knot I ever learned. To me, clowning it was a way of relaxation for me. You regressed into childhood, you were able to relax. And you could be goofy if you wanted to. And still you had the facade of your face being covered. I used to do clowning, and I don't know if you want to mention the name, for an ice cream company in Chicago, who had 33 flavors. I'm serious, Bressler Ice Cream Company. I was their contractor, and I was also their clown. And Pogo the Clown was the clowning that I did for charity hospital work for the Democratic Party in that. And Pogo the Clown is originally. Pogo comes from being Polish and on the go all the time, so it's Pogo. I always felt that service community and community service to others, you know, in my religious background, I felt if you serve other people, it'll come back to serve you. Mm-hmm. You know, I've always believed that way with generosity.
What's your life like?
Day to day? I live it day to day.
What do you mean?
If you want to know what my life is like, I log it every day. For the last 12 years, all you got to do is ask. I can tell you everything. I can tell you if the first meal they served me here because I do it daily.
What do you do all day?
Every phone call, everything that I do, every time an officer's around me is logged. Every movement that I make is in the book here. You know, when I tell you I've got background information on it, we took each one of them by, we took each one of the victims, and this is by their names or by their indictment numbers. And what we did with each one of them, we did profile sheets on them. We wanted to know what this kid was into, what his background was. My dad was domineering in effect. He had a different set of values, but also very stern individual. My dad drank a lot. When he drank a lot, yeah, he was abusive to my mother and to me. But I never swung at my dad because I loved him for what he stood for.
Why the skeleton?
This was done by request. Somebody requested a skull clown, and mostly the punk rockers and the undergrounders like that stuff there. This is Christ as I see him in myself. And it's monolithic because Christ, to me, is monolithic. He's all things to all people. This here is the Hi-Ho series, and that is self-explanatory. It's the Seven Dwarfs. And they've always stuck to me as a great child painting. And so I've done a series of Hi-Ho series paintings. And this is the 1990 one. This is called Hi-Ho Around the Campfire. It's an original work. Walt Disney is a mentor for me because I've always enjoyed his creativity. And the Seven Dwarfs, if you actually look at all the faces, they represent the seven different moods that most people can get into. And nowadays, do you realize by 1993 that 50% of the American families will be single-parented? And that shows a breakdown in the church and not being able to hold families together. And for this reason, children run away from home and seek love in other places. What do I think of Jeffrey Dahmer? I don't know the man personally, but I'll tell you this. That's a good example as to why insanity doesn't belong in a courtroom. Because if Jeffrey Dahmer doesn't meet the requirements for insanity, then I'd hate like hell to run into the guy that does.
Do you feel
beyond
so?
That, I have no comment on Jeffrey Dahmer because I'm not Jeffrey Dahmer. And I would not, whether it's Berkowitz, whether it's Bundy, whether it's Williams, Wayne Williams down in Atlanta, or any of the others, or Charlie Manson, see, I don't comment about other cases for the simple fact is that I wasn't there.
Do you feel somewhat of a kinship with some
no.
of these people?
No. God, I hate that when they put me in the same club with them. I'm not only the victim here. I may be the 34th victim, but there are other victims to this crime, and that is the family. Because if I know that I didn't commit the crime, then I have been given the injustice, and so has the families. And nobody gives a damn about the families. That one mother that gets on television all the time who thinks I should be given 33 injections. I think she ought to take 33 Valiums and go lay down. She goes on Geraldo's show and all these other shows talking about, I think it's the name. Her Marine son, if her Marine son was so great, what the hell did he run away from home 12 times?
Not enough for him to be murdered.
I know that. There's a misconception of what the house on Summerdale is. It's not a house where you work 9 to 5 and come home, and it's like a house where you live in. The living room was the private office section. One of the bedrooms was a terrarium. The kitchen was more like a fast food kitchen. We have always contended there's others involved. At the time of my arrest, there was four other suspects. Three of the suspects that we knew that they knew then was Michael Rossi, David Cram, and Philip Paskey, all employees of PDM contractors, all with keys to the house on Summerdale. I met him the night he was killed because I met him with Michael Rossi. I had a drink with the two of them, and then I left. And when I next seen the individual, he was dead.
Where did you see
him? Why didn't I say something about it? Because it wasn't my business, and I stayed out of other people's business.
Where did you see him dead?
In the house on Summerdale.
And did Rossi tell you who had killed him?
No, Rossi didn't say nothing. Rossi was sleeping on a couch. I just left.
And how did he get buried? Do you know?
He was buried in the crawl space. When I come back, he wasn't there. So, Walter, that's your guess as to who put him in the ground and that. No, I started back in 1984. I started taking 10 milligram of Valium, and by the time 1978 came around, I was doing 130 milligram of Valium. But then I was moving 80 jobs a year, and I was working 16, 18-hour days, and I just had to have something to take the pressure off. When I was arrested, they claimed, well, there was a putrefied odor in the house. And I contend that was a lot of hogwash, too, because one officer, Schultz, claims on the 18th or on the 19th that as he came into the house, we had come into the house, and my little Lhasa Apso was in the house. And, of course, he had been locked in the kitchen, you know, all day. Well, a little puppy, he piddles, see, and while he's piddling and while he is doing his business on the paper and that, you can imagine what it smells like if you go into a closed room. And when the heat came on, as soon as the heat came on, it'd give you, you know, that strong feces odor. You know, I found it as odd when we bought the house that a house with a crawl space would need a sump pump. But then I learned the first time it rained that this ground gets wet under there, and the crawl space actually floods up to a foot deep in water. And then as it recedes, it puts out a musty odor. There was always a musty odor in that house.
Oh.
I'm just as lovable and jokeable as I was back then. You know, I don't sit around worrying about the death penalty or things like that, no.
How could you not?
If you believe you've lived your life the right way, then you do not have nothing to fear, in my case.
You're not worried about facing God?
No. I'm fairly comfortable with him. I've been at the Catholic services, I'm the server for the priest for the last 10 years. I have no qualms about doing that. I've had confession, I have communion, and I am at peace with myself.